Les experts du GIEC estiment que 50 à 70% des solutions au changement climatique ont vocation à être mises en œuvre à l'échelle des villes, à l'échelle des municipalités. Et donc, en effet, les décisions prises au niveau des communes, au niveau du territoire, sont celles qui touchent directement nos modes de vie, à travers nos lieux de vie, nos lieux de travail, nos réseaux de transport, l'énergie, l'alimentation. Et donc, la question aujourd'hui, c'est de voir en quoi, comment, quelle pertinence du niveau local on a pour penser global et agir localement, comment l'échelle municipale, l'échelle de la ville est le premier levier d'action. Qu'est-ce que les maires ont comme pouvoir d'action à cette échelle?
One of the main issues, one of the main barriers that we encountered when we wanted to increase the impact of what we were doing was precisely working with the public administration. The project has been running since early 2017, and we started by identifying what systems were out there already trying to address this problem. How can we better collaborate between civil society and public administration? Therefore, the system that we have designed aims to create a path for cultural change. So the first thing that we work on is creating a system for shared governance. That is why we use a system called Sociocracy 3.0. Talking about power is a little bit like talking about money. It's taboo, it's difficult, it touches upon very deep things. That's why it's such an important point that needs to be discussed from the very beginning.
The problem is that we are very often framing the issue of climate change as a global problem only, including ourselves, social movements, right? We're somehow building it from the top. Yes, we are facing one of the biggest, one of the most complex issues we've ever faced. We are probably facing what is, you know, the existential crisis of our time and probably, you know, the most important issue humanity has ever faced. But the fact that this crisis and this catastrophe is bigger and stronger and more worrying than any other doesn't mean that we shouldn't move step by step, one foot after the other. Change has to begin somewhere. And that somewhere comes very often down to local scales, local places, territories where we live our day-to-day lives. Working at the local level to try and tackle climate change probably means to try and articulate two poles. The first pole is the resistance. The second pole are the alternatives. So the resistance means basically first blocking everything that is destroying the world, the climate, our ecosystem, our territories. The other part of the resistance is non-cooperation. All the attempts by which we say individually and collectively, not in our name, with our money. And there again, local authorities do have a lot of power, right? Because local authorities can clearly say, well, actually, we do represent, if it's a big city, potentially up to several millions of inhabitants. And we were elected on a platform that is very clear about climate change. And that platform does include that we are not going to invest our pension fund, that we are not going to invest the money, you know, that we're raising through taxes and so on and so forth, that we are not going to invest that money in the fossil fuel industry.
Municipalities and cities have been increasingly perceived as key players in meeting the challenges of working towards sustainable and low carbon future. And of course, we recognize that municipalities can play a critical role in facilitating energy transition and in particular wider public engagement. What has been also one of the learnings is that municipalities have often highlighted their preference to follow examples and demonstrated inclination to learn from one another. And some good examples of such good practices were shared across the continent. Given the scale and the urgency of climate crisis, there is a need for action towards decarbonization across all levels of government. And municipal level can be a very fruitful ground for innovation. biggest challenge, as I already mentioned, is very evident in difficulty to secure funding for transition. Particularly, this is related to availability of national and international funding, very often very volatile, offering only unstable or periodical windows of opportunity for municipalities.
Nuestro modelo de alimentación es altamente dependiente del clima, es decir, para producir alimentos necesitamos una serie de condiciones climáticas y es fácil de entender que esta emergencia climática que estamos viviendo afecta a nuestra capacidad productiva de alimentos y esto contrasta con la creciente urbanización de la población mundial y la previsión es que en 2050 el 68% de la población mundial viva en ciudades. Con lo cual podemos entender como necesario planificar cómo esta población que vive en entornos urbanos no productivos se va a alimentar de una manera sostenible. La agricultura, la pesca son responsables del 23% de las emisiones totales de gases de efecto invernadero, ¿no? Esto, como os decía, demuestra la dependencia que tienen los sistemas alimentarios de estas energías fósiles, tanto en su producción, por el uso de fertilizantes, maquinaria, como en su industrialización y distribución, ¿no? De larga distancia. Tenemos que tener en cuenta que hay un trabajo importante que tenemos que hacer desde las ciudades y es reconectar la ciudad con el territorio en el cual se sitúa. Es importante reconstruir estos lazos, que son lazos históricos que se rompieron con la globalización y que hoy en día, reconectando, nos permiten estimular la producción de estos entornos periurbanos y acortar las cadenas de comercialización y de producción.